Well, we're back at Los Angeles Airport now, Lex Airport it's called, or Lexative as we know it. It's about 7 in the morning, we're going to go down to Miami now. It's been interesting, we've been here for a week, we've met the stars, we've met the record company, we've met the musicians and the artists. And I think it's an experience that will probably stay with me for at least 15 minutes or so. I've got this, Your Majesty, this is rather interesting thing here. This is an underwater camera so I can get snapshots of the police. There's trouble. It seems to be moving. Really exciting, eh? Anyone can look out and pretend one's driving it. Oh, this is fun, isn't it, eh? I'm not going to do this. Oh, it's about being a train driver. Now you're waiting for me then. If you look over there, you'll see they haven't quite actually finished the international airport. But the plane managed to land. I mean, Christ, you know, what do you want? Bring your own seats, eh?
Ready? Jumps away then.
Okay, well, we're just about to go straight off and go for a takeoff. Here we go then.
Get ready.
Just as well, we waited a minute, eh? See the pilot checking all of the instruments as we're going up. You can see somebody's had the cassette player out of it there.
Right then. Here we are. As I said, in Montserrat International Airport. A bit of a dodgy flight. Still, we're going to the customs house, see if they'll accept my passport. If I have nothing to wear, then I'm British. Anybody in there? Try around the other side, eh? I'll tell a few of you who don't know, maybe some of you might be under the impression that Montserrat is in the south of France or somewhere like that. Well, you'd be really stupid, like myself, if you're under that impression, because I found out after it took me a few days to travel here that in fact it isn't. It's just down from the Florida coast, and it was discovered originally by Christopher Columbus, and then it started to get inhabited. Presumably, Christopher Columbus planted his seed amongst the natives. And altogether, it's about 100 square kilometres. Its main produce is limes and fruit and that sort of thing. And its capital, strangely enough, because the British took it over, I don't know, 18th century, I'd imagine. And its capital is called Plymouth, which is quite unusual. I don't know if we're going to be staying in Plymouth, or maybe Torbay. Well, I can't seem to find any customs on about. It says in the British passport, for those of you who got them, it says, let the bearer pass without let or hindrance. What about having bloody said hello? Well, welcome to Montserrat, old Isle of the Caribbean. Sounds good. Montserrat then, 12,000 people, 39 square miles. Where do you start? You could start here, on the backyard of the island, or the outside toilet, as some will call it. From the top or the bottom, in the very centre of the island, to the most desolate. Or just driving between places, you can see the buildings new and old. Cathedrals and churches, Her Majesty's prison, the bad Montserrat people. Wide streets, narrow streets, people who have your dough, the inland revenue. And the place to win all the money in the pool's office. And this is where you put the money that you've won. And Montserrat Market. The night spots, the harbour, and the radio station, Radio Antilles. And ladies with things on their heads. And men with things on their heads. Well, there's 12,000 people on this island, so perhaps they deserve a mention as well. Young lads. And the working men. The female. And the resting man. Piggies, cows, goats, donkeys. And now we're with the wealthiest man on Montserrat. He hasn't spoken a word for 15 years. This man owns Montserrat 15 miles that way and 12 miles that way. He has two Rolls Royces but always uses this donkey. He's never said a word until maybe now he could say something to us. No. My God, we were lucky to meet him though. Thank you.
Okay.
He said something! Well, of course, on a tropical island such as this, you get their main produce is fruits, such as bananas, mangoes, coconut tree, famous four-legged banana tree. Oh, of course, hello. Of course, on the other hand, you can come down here, you get a boat like this, and you can go out to the sea and have a good fish. And behind me there are the famous fishermen of Montserrat, known as the most sporting fishermen in the Caribbean, because it's only once a week that they'll take these boats out and catch the fish. The rest of the time, they'll just do it with their bare hands like that, no nets or nothing. And that's what I call a real sporting fisherman. Well, we were just on our way from place to place, And then we thought we'd stop at this place. I'm not sure what it was that attracted us to it. Or, of course, alternatively, we could start here on this side of the island, which is the Dodo Flies. It's about 4 miles across the mountainous terrain. Or by road, as we came, we had to drive all around the island to get here. This side, unlike the other side, there are no sharks, no dangerous things at all. It's quite safe to swim in the charming, sun-drenched beaches. I'm told that even if we climb down into the water and have a swim, you can see fishes coming up to you like this, and you can just pluck them out and eat them raw, and they're a real delicacy. So let's go and have a go and a bite to eat, maybe, shall we? Okay, well, the water here is just as warm as Biggles Wade swimming bath, which is pretty warm, let me tell you. So let's just all just throw off and see what we can see, eh? Or for the more cowardly ones, we can stay up here in the swimming pool. Or one can come up here to the full-size table for a rather good game of pool. And I must say that the lawns are really perfect for it at this time of year. Or the occasional game of tennis. Or alternatively, Montserrat's famous underwater golf course. Anyway, coming out to see if we could see any of the local nightlife. Well, that seems to be about the size of the local nightlife here anyway. If we move over a bit, you can see a white building up in the hillside there. And that white building is the famous Montserrat Studios, which George Martin, who used to produce the Beatles, he has that studio. It's Air Montserrat, and he has one called Air in London. It's on this tropical paradise where the rich and famous bands can record their music to their best ability. Is the studio different in itself in there, or is the studio the same as the one in Leatherhead inside?
It's exactly the same.
Yeah. Totally. Does it cost a lot more to come here than it does to Leatherhead, if you don't mind me asking?
No.
Really?
No.
Why does anybody ever go to Leatherhead? Why did you go to Leatherhead in the first place? What a wally. You know, I would have come here straight away.
We didn't have the imagination to come to here.
Ah, first, I see.
Just coming. Yeah, that's just the straight, that's from the flanger. Yeah. Then you add the echo on. Here the sound gets bigger, and then you put the compression. That's a compressor. Play like Message in a Bottle was played like this.
And could you just play that? So you could, people can hear what it sounds like without any of the effects at all, without using this pedal at all. What would that then sound like?
Well, it's different to like this.
Guitar, is that ever influenced you at all?
Yeah, I spent about 5 years playing classical guitar. I don't think I can remember much of it, but I did put in a lot of time doing that. And it's come out in some numbers that we've played together. One song, Bring on the Night, is played with a sort of a classical arpeggio. It's a little finger style thing. That relates like to some classical pieces like Villalobos.
So now from this giant pedal here,
yes,
I'd like to go to this small blue box here.
Ah,
and you tell me what this one does.
Yeah, well, this is the Roland guitar synthesizer. Here's the guitar. Here's
you have the to have that guitar to go with it there.
Yes, because all the controls are built into the guitar that operate this part of the setup. This is the second one they've made. The first one was very nice but not very easy to use on stage. It was too complicated. This one is great because it's on the floor and you can switch everything off and on with your foot. And it sounds like this. See, I like to use this pedal with it because it opens the filter.
Yeah, it gives
on
it
the foot.
Great
yeah,
reward.
That's right.
Is that the effect that you used on Don't Stand So Close?
That's exactly it.
Did you use any of this with this as well?
Yes, I also use the pedal board in conjunction with this. I usually use the flanger and the echoplex with the synthesizer. And the guitar solo in the middle is played on this guitar. But to achieve the effect that is on the record, I use the duet switch here, which means that you can add an extra interval to any note you're playing. And I like to tune the synthesizer, the guitar synthesizer, in fifths. And then play strange chords as well. And then
so what effect does that give?
Well, you get a very strange sound. This is now, I've just switched it into fifths. So, sounds like this.
What would that sound like without the fifths?
Fifths is straight, it's a straight sound like this. You can see. See, now this down here, this one switch will switch in any interval you want. So this is tuned in fifths now, so you get this. See? Unison.
Do you ever press the wrong button?
Usually, yeah.
Handy with such a big pedal, having small feet, really, I suppose.
Yes, I've actually, I'm out doing Rudolf Nureyev with this thing.
So tell me about, I want to know, as do we all, about more of your influences, your guitar influences. I mean, were you influenced like lots of guitarists were by the blues?
Yes,
I mean, what sort of blues guitar? If I say blues guitar, what would you break out into?
One, two, three, four.
about funk stuff? Are you into funk?
Oh, yeah. Well, I think all three of us enjoy playing. We don't actually do much on record in funk, but it is something that we like to play, this one.
Actually, that's probably best left to James Brown, isn't it, really?
Yeah, I think it was, yes.
But how about, in the meantime, I mean, the you've got other influences other than just guitarists, I mean?
Can I do a bit more funk? What?
Well, if you've got to.
Oh, right, that's all right.
But, I mean, are there keyboard players, saxophone players? Do you find those a big influence on your guitar playing?
Yes, well, I listened to all sorts of musicians in the past. John Coltrane, I like very much. Still love to listen to. Ornette Coleman.
Yeah. How about jazz? Is that an influence in your playing?
Oh, always has been, yeah. Well, I started off really playing that kind of thing. That's the first thing I graduated towards. And then I moved out of that and played. And I've played rock music most of my life, but jazz music is something. One, two,
from
Thank you. Sting, we're here in Montserrat and you're doing your fourth album. And you find it, when you're coming in the studio, increasingly difficult to match what you've done before, because you've had such big hits, you've got to get one better than that.
I think the recording process gets easier as we get more and more experienced at doing it. You know, we come in and we have a sort of formula, we just get down to it. Whereas in the first place, we were kind of experimenting with roles and what exactly to do. What I do find increasingly hard is writing material.
Mm-hmm.
And topping your last best song is a nightmare.
Mm.
When I wrote Roxanne, I thought, I like that, it's really good. Mm. Will I ever write one better? And then I wrote Message in the Bottle, which I thought was better than Roxanne. And you go on, you do actually better yourself, but it becomes harder and harder.
What's your favourite of your songs so far?
My favourite song is probably Message in the Bottle, both lyrically and musically. I think it's the most unified piece I've written.
When do you get time to write? I mean, if you're on the road most of the time, which you are, I mean, do you write when you're on the road?
I've got lots of little boxes, excuse me. I wrote Message in a Bottle in a bus, in the back of a bus on this.
Uh-huh.
Which is a tape recorder with a drum machine in. Show you. It's supposed to go off now. Yeah. Play along with it, you know. Like this. In the back of a bus.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's nice.
So, well, let's go in to Message in a Bottle, then. Well, I mean, how did you write that?
Well, let's go further back, even. I mean, you, as a songwriter, as a composer, you like the sound of certain chords, and I like the sound of, say, D minor ninth, but I also like what follows it, which is A9.
Yeah.
And the combination is... Oh, that's good. That's good. I like that. Where do we take it from there? Go up to B, F sharp. And over two bars, you've got a sequence. And you start humming along.
So the music comes first, does it, before any lyrics?
No,
there?
That's not true. It comes from two different areas. You put your music hat on,
and
you sit and write a riff, and then you go away with your notepad and you write lyrics down.
Yeah.
And sooner or later, they meet. But by using tape recorders, you can keep track of your ideas because they sort of fly around your head.
So, I mean, with Message in a Bottle, were all the bits there, did they all come at once, or did you have like one bit there?
No, it all happened very slowly. As I say, I had this sequence going on of the chords.
Yeah.
By arpeggiating, you get the riff. So we stick it down.
This is how you demoed it and presented it to the band, is it?
I get home from the bus.
Yeah.
And I stick Dennis the drum box on.
Yeah, there he goes.
Because Stuart's not always available.
No. Probably keeps better time, really.
I set this tape recorder away, like so, and put this riff down, just for memory.
Yeah.
Mistakes as well.
Yeah.
Wind it back, turn Dennis off.
Yeah.
Leave it for a day, go back to it, listen to it, and play along with it, see what happens. Play some sort of harmony with it.
Yeah. Before you've even got to like another part, like a chorus or something like that.
Yeah. Well, just muck around. Where are we? Put a harmony on it.
Uh-huh.
Like. Thing is, you know, most nights that you do that, it sounds awful.
Yeah.
I've had too much to drink, or the riff in the first place was lousy. In this case, it was good. So then you think, well, what should I do next? Put Dennis back on. Go on. Ah, there he is. You think, right, that's a good verse, right? Let's have some rock and roll in it.
Would this be something that you maybe come up with before, like an idea for a
maybe
chorus?
Maybe it's in the, you know, you pile the tapes away. Because it hasn't fitted anywhere.
Mm.
And all the time you're sort of mumbling rubbish, you know.
Mm.
And when you've got a reasonable structure, you know, written with a chorus, you go to the big pile of lyrics, which you write all the time. You can write them anywhere. You can write them at a bus stop, you can write them in the pub. And you just look through them and you see Message in a Bottle. Oh, that's an interesting title, because I write from titles.
Yeah.
I don't write the first line of a song.
Yeah.
It's a mistake, because then you have to come up with the second one.
Mm.
If you write backwards from the chorus line,
yeah,
which is usually the hook,
yeah,
then you usually come up with it. So I had this Message in a Bottle. What's Message in a Bottle about? It's usually about some guy with the raggy trousers, yeah, and a beard on a desert, yeah, island.
Well, how then, I mean, so you've got the rough idea for the chorus there, and then the idea for the verse. So how then do you present it to the
band?
Well,
you join all the bits of tape together, mm-hmm, in a sort of rough fashion, you know, with sort of very rough parts, mm-hmm, on, and say, hello, Andy and Stuart, I've got a new song. And they go, mm-hmm. No, it's really good, I promise, it's dead good. And, you know, they learn it, and then they adapt it and change it.
Yeah.
It's lucky to have brilliant musicians.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, they said that.
We're paying each other, but, you know, you could go along to, say, some Duff musicians, and they wouldn't get the same thing out of the same material.
So you had 4 weeks in which to write most of the material, mm-hmm, for this album. Did you find it sort of only came in the last week or something like that?
No, as I say, I write in bits and bobs, you know, a bit here, a bit there. It is like a jigsaw.
Yeah.
In the last week
you had, yeah, all the... Oh, that will go with that one.
Yeah.
Well, you were mentioning a song a minute ago that's going to be on this new album.
One song I really like on the album is called Invisible Sun, which I wrote on this thing here. This is my pedals.
Really? It was actually written on this?
Well, yeah, in a way. This is like a foot piano, which I play on stage. Has a bass sound. I've also got a synthesizer sound.
Yeah.
So I was just sitting at home one night with... Played E-flat on there. And I played this. Great.
So it was straight down, yeah?
Straight
Did Dennis
down.
Get involved?
Dennis was involved at a later date, like, yeah, so. That's all right. Change the chord. You can see why we have Andy Summers in the group.
Yeah. He's a man for the chords.
No, he's a man for playing the guitar.
Oh, I say, yeah.
I bring these Duff.
Did you? I mean,
renditions along to him.
When you do give the song to the band, do you always go into a rehearsal room first, or do you come straight into the recording studio?
We haven't got time to go rehearsal.
No.
Room. We go straight in the studio, and if it's not happening within half an hour, we ditch it.
Go on to something else.
Yeah, we're very impatient, but I think that's a good way. The pressure's always,
yeah,
on. You know, it has to be good very soon, very quickly.
Yeah.
If it's not, out the window.
Do you have it live, or do you have a lot of overdubs and edits?
It usually has to work with the three musicians playing it and me singing.
Yeah.
And that's usually good enough.
Yeah. Okay, well, of course, the other member of the band that we can now meet is Brian. Sting?
Yes, this is Brian. He's one of a kind. And he's had his ghoulies chopped off.
Brian, eh?
Off with the ghoulies. Yeah, he used to have one of those, you know, sort of bell-shaped...
All around him, yeah.
...violin. A big violin. So he gave him the operation.
Yeah.
And ended up with this and electrified.
He's not all high-pitched, is he?
What?
Go on, sorry.
Yeah, a bit too clever, aren't you? Not, he's hollow, you see. He's not like one of those pogo sticks with strings on. Play like, sound like cricket bats. It's got, you know, it's got a sound.
Was he specially made for you?
He was specially made for me by a man called Van Zellinger. Stuart's got one as well. Creep. See? Lovely rich sound. Look, stop acting like an idiot when you play the piano.
Okay then.
Prove
yourself to be an idiot.
Pretend he doesn't know any of the answers.
Right then.
Do you know, no, I can't say that. Play some in C.
Okay.
Some white notes, right?
Yep.
I'll try and play some white notes on here. 1, 2. 1, 2. Somebody with skill. Oh! It's Andy Peterson.
Learn that Django Reinhardt piece yet?
Yeah.
Like that?
That's great, yes. I'd like to talk to you, actually, especially about your drum kit, because it's one of the most unusual drum kits I've ever seen. And also the effects that you've got over there. I mean, there's a lot of it. Well, first of all, tell us about these tom-toms up here.
These are octobands. Yeah. They're really long. Perhaps you'll recognize a famous theme from Grieg.
Yes, that sort of thing, yeah. Now, if we could just look at this over here, because this is the thing that fascinates me. On stage, you use all this, and while you're recording, I presume you use it all.
Well, I don't use it when I'm recording, because I don't really have to. These gadgets here, they have better ones actually in the studio. These are for going on the road.
So what is this then?
This is a time delay unit.
And what does that do?
It's an echo, it's a repeat echo. Sorry, I forgot that was still going. See that echo? Let's see, let's have something familiar. The beginning of Regatta de Blanc has got some echo on it. I'll play that. Sort of thing.
Astonishing, isn't it?
Astonishing.
I mean, amazing. What about these blocks here?
These are just wood blocks. They've been around for a long time. They're just wood blocks.
And how about this here, this claptrap?
The claptrap is fake clapping. It doesn't really work very well. This one's a bit faulty, but I'll see if it's working. You see, there's a microphone on the drum, and the microphone picks up the sound and triggers this device here, which actually sounds like this, or longer. But as I told you, it's broken.
Uh-huh.
And it just makes the snare drum sound bigger for the fat backbeat. You know, when you're cruising along and you're playing, and sometimes you just want the backbeat to overtake everything. Well, I have a running battle with Sting and his drumming machine.
What do you think of drum machines generally?
They're great. I use them all the time myself for writing songs and just for playing with, because they make great sounds. But the feel that you get from three pieces working together and everything is very different. Sometimes we do record a track with the drum box, and I'll overdub the drums on top of them rather than the other way around. The drummer is the person in the studio who has to work the hardest at first, because you have to get it right. When you're doing a track, bass, guitar, drums, you play the song. We work the song out for about half an hour, and then we immediately turn the tape on and play it. None of us have heard it before half an hour ago, but we start playing it. And usually we get it within two or three takes. But the drums are what I'm stuck with for the rest of my life. The guitars and the bass, you can overdo and everything.
Yeah.
You redo those, you can get a better sound, you can make sure the tuning's right, even if you want to change the key of the song. Occasionally, Sting will get to sing the song, and you say, wait a minute, it's all in the wrong key. So they keep the drum track and erase all the guitars, all the everything, and start from scratch again on top of the drums. What it means is that you have to get it right on those first few days of recording. All the pressure's on, because you're stuck with it for a long time after that.
I mean, obviously, you like melodies, but are there
I'm struck by melodies, and I really like melodies. In fact, I'm a frustrated guitar player. I wish I could play guitar. In fact, I do play lots of guitar, and piano, and all these things. But the thing that comes most easily is drums, and it's also very fun to play, I suppose. Drums are really easy to play. I don't know if it's just because I find it that way, but they really are. They're a joke. Anyone can do this.
Why is your drumming different from another drummer?
Longer arms. I play with my feet. I suppose it's because I've stolen all my licks from different sources. You see, all the licks, they all get passed back and forth, most of them. And the trick is to find new ones and turn them around a little bit, camouflage them a little bit, and express yourself with the same sticks and the same cymbals and the same configuration of things to bash with new ways of doing it. And my source of licks has been South America and, of course, the West Indies. And those are a really big difference.
Because a lot of people say that it's white man's reggae or reggae influenced. I mean, do you think that's...
Let's examine this word reggae.
Let's.
The main rock and roll stuff, which everything's based on, even since the jazz days, since they're going... And then they went, you know... And then got funky. And all that stuff, the backbeat. Or it's always a backbeat, which goes on...
One, two.
That's right, one, two, three, four. And that backbeat, which is on all the Beatles records, on all the Rolling Stones records, on all the... Yeah, all the Motown records, all the jazz records, all the way up through the Billy Cobham records. I mean, they've all got a backbeat.
On 2 and 4.
On 2 and 4. And if you count that, 2 and 4 means 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. Now, reggae turns the whole rhythm upside down. This drum set is designed by jazz drummers and stuff like that. It's been evolved that way to work that format. But over in Jamaica, they got it wrong or something. I don't know how they ended up. They turned the whole thing upside down and have invented something really different. And it's the most different thing that's been invented since the drum set was invented, since the backbeat itself, which is the basis for all of the kind of music that everybody in America and England has been listening to. And the difference is that it lands, they use the bass drum in a different place. It goes. Three. It's 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3. And the bass drum and the snare drum both land in the same place. I have no idea how it's ever was arrived at. It's brilliant. It's an absolute, it's a paradigm for the cosmos.
It's easy. Anyone can do it. So I think I'll have a go. Can't be that hard, right? Every third beat. Easy. Anyone can do it.